Hello, class. Welcome to your lecture on the Eleatics, Parmenides, Zeno, and Melissus. Parmenides of Elea flourished around 480 BCE, the settlement at Elea or Velia dating to around 530 BCE. This may be significant because of the specific form of Greek religious cult and practice among the Phocians in Spain, influencing the specific form of Greek religion that Parmenides would be brought up in. He is most often introduced, probably wrongly, as the opposite of Heraclitus. Heraclitus had taught that everything flows. For Parmenides, everything is stagnant. This is a very persistent and common misinterpretation. Parmenides' doctrine of being might be more accurately stated as the more things change, the more they stay the same. Presenting his philosophy in the almost exclusively religious form of the Prome, and under the direct inspiration of various gods and goddesses, especially the unnamed goddess who speaks the truth, it is odd that at the same time Parmenides is considered the father of logic and the principle of identity. Whatever is, and what is not. In a book, Reality, by Peter Kingsley, it's underlined that Parmenides seems to have been an iatromantis, or doctor, in healing cults of Apollo and Asclepius, as indicated by the inscription of his name in healing sanctuaries during and after his time in Velia. He wrote a poem in hexameter verse addressed to his pupil Zeno, and it was divided into three parts: the prologue, the way of truth, and the way of opinion. His discovery of logic occurs in the course of a visionary revelation from an unnamed goddess. Many say she's Alethea, but other contenders have been proposed. Parmenides was in the second generation of Greeks who had settled in the colony of Elea in southern Italy, and so his philosophy came to be known as Eleatic. The question of where Parmenides' grandparents were before coming to Elea will prove important. In any case, during his lifetime, he was said to have been a student of Pythagoras and then of Xenophanes, some even say of Anaximander. Plato wrote a dialogue in his honor. The Parmenides and his successors are Zeno and Melissus and Empedocles. Socrates may have listened to and been inspired by him directly as a young man. It's often said that he refuted Heraclitus' doctrine of becoming, an Ionian material monism. I think this view is incorrect, although Stamatelos and our textbook gives more of this standard story. Parmenides' poem was entitled On Nature and was written in a traditional form of Homeric hexameter. So what's up with Parmenides' poem? Thankfully, it was preserved by Simplicius, at least the prologue, in its entirety. We only have fragments of the Way of Truth and bits and pieces of the Way of Opinion. The poem begins with a spiritual journey undertaken by a young man, a Kouros, to an unnamed goddess. The young man, likely Parmenides himself, is driven in a flying chariot by daughters of Helios, following the sun's path to this unnamed goddess who reveals to him the possible ways of inquiry, the unshaken heart of truth, and the doubtful opinions of mortals. The style of the prologue is allegorical and autobiographical. Image of the youth in the chariot being a definite precursor of the image of the chariot found in Plato's Phaedrus. In fact, Plato's myth of the conflictual soul, always torn and conflicted between its appetites and its noble-spirited parts, as well as its reason, the charioteer, be seen as a development of Parmenides' spiritual journey. Looking at some of the opening lines of the poem, we can see just how very poetic it is. The mares which bear me as far as my desire reaches, in Greek, Hupoi tai me ferousin, oson tepi thumos ikanoi. Note here, the ferousin, the mares which bear him, were conveying me when they led me into the many-voiced way. Pempon epaimes odon besan, polufemon agusai. Greek is normally very beautiful, but the bearing me ferousin and the polufemon, many-voiced, then all come together in the third line of a deity who leads the knowing mortals straight on through all things. Daimonos, no daimonos, not theon, he katapan anten, ferai aidota fota tai feromen. The metonymic, that is, same sound, metaphoricity of these opening lines is easily missed in translation, but note how the carrying of the mares into the many-voiced way leads in this alliterative and metonymic play into the leading into the heart of things. These poetic plays on feres, or to be carried, the same root in our English word metaphor, is explicitly underlined by Parmenides: by this way I was born, typheromen. For by this way the well-discerning mares bore me as they drew the chariot and the maidens guided the way, that is, the Heliades, or daughters of the sun. and the axles and the naves would screech like a pipe. This seems to be some sort of mystical initiatory sound at the threshold of some ultimate revelation. As it blazed, for it was driven by two whirling wheels, one on each side. When the maiden daughters of the sun hastened to escort me, having left the house of night, for the light having pushed back their veils from their faces with their hands. Sometimes scholars will say that Parmenides' poem begins this way, so religiously, without any note of philosophy at all, because of the convention of the poets. In order to be taken seriously, they begin their poems, like in Hesiod, with an invocation of their muse and promise that everything they will tell came directly from the muse. Such a way of reading Parmenides' poem merely in terms of literary convention is a tidy way to ignore and overlook that the origin of logic, its gift to humanity, in fact entirely occurs in the realm of a religious initiation. Possibly make us assume that the opening of a poem like this is merely a ploy to gain religious readerships for philosophy. An absurd way of understanding Parmenides, to be sure. Next up in this revelatory itinerary, Parmenides arrives at the gates of the path of day and night, and a lintel spans them and a stone threshold. Walter Burkhardt notes that this image is already decisive for the content of Parmenidean philosophy. Parmenides does not describe a descent or catabasis into the underworld and realm of Persephone like the Orphics, nor does he describe, and this more controversially, an anabasis or mere ascent. Parmenides' journey is not to the above or to the below, but rather straight through the horizon, that is, the liminal, to a place between day and night and the origin of day and night, an eternal twilight in which a lintel spans them and a stone threshold. Parmenidean image of thought is thus horizontal and not vertical, emphasizing the in-between and neither transcendence nor immanence. And there, in the absolute horizon, the ethereal gates themselves are filled with grand doors, and much avenging justice holds their alternating keys. Already we've met many goddesses and divine figures in Parmenides' poem, Heliades, or maiden daughters of the sun, night and day, and now justice. Note that justice does not at first want to admit Parmenides to what lies beyond the threshold, but persuading her with gentle words, the maiden skillfully convinced her that she should push away the bolted bar quickly from the gates, and they made a yawning gap in the doorway as they flew open, causing the two bronze hinges fitted with rivets and pins to rotate. In tandem in their sockets, here then the maidens held the chariot and mares straight through them on the wagon road. Earlier, the axles and naves in the chariot had themselves screeched like a pipe, an initiatory sign, and here it's the sockets and hinges in the gateway, overseen by justice. What a detailed account of a shamanic initiatory journey, and me, the goddess, graciously welcomed, took my right hand in hers, and addressing me said, O youth, companion to immortal charioteers, goddess hails Parmenides, hail, since no evil fate sent you forth to travel this way. For indeed it is far from the track of men, but right and justice. It is right for you to learn all things, both the unshaken heart of persuasive truth and the opinions of mortals in which there is no true reliance. But nevertheless, you shall learn this too, all things being just completely. Come now, and I shall tell, and you receive through hearing the tale, which are the ways of inquiry for thinking. The one, that it is and that it is not possible not to be, is the path of persuasion, for she attends truth. The other, that it is not, and that it should not be, this I declare to you, an utterly inscrutable track, for neither could you know what is not, for it cannot be accomplished, nor could you declare it or point it out. Talk about getting straight to the punch. Note how in this direct speech of the goddess, truth is mentioned many times. The goddess does not identify herself as truth, rather as speaking on behalf of it. What Parmenides shall learn is the unshaking heart of well-rounded or persuasive truth. Persuasion, Pytho, is another goddess here who attends on truth. It's not clear that we can identify the goddess as Aletheia, the goddess of truth. Deification or personification of the concept truth we find only in one other place in the Greek canon, that is in Epimenides. But nor is it unclear, since the goddess speaks most entirely of truth, although perhaps here of herself only in the third person. On the question of the identity of Parmenides' unnamed goddess beyond the gates of Dike and Thamus, Heidegger follows Carl Reinhardt in thinking that she is Aletheia, and does not consider the other contenders that have been proposed, such as Nyx, Night, Anarche, Necessity, Hemera, Dawn, Moira, Fate, Nemosune, Memory, or even Hestia, a figure who frequently appears in Pythagorean thought in much the same types of contexts. The only other reference to the goddess Aletheia comes in the pre-Socratic philosopher Epimenides, who claimed to have encountered both Aletheia and Dike in an incubatory dream in a Cretan cave. He was the original Rumpelstiltskin, having slept in the cave for a very long time and then emerged with his revelation from Truth and Justice. Other than this, however, there is scant archaic or classical testimony to corroborate the personification of truth as a goddess. Nevertheless, Heidegger claims that Parmenides' poem speaks by bringing into language the word of the goddess Aletheia in propria persona, in her own person, and in whose sphere and ritual presence the beginning and the retreat of initiatory disclosure takes place. For Heidegger here, Parmenides is indeed the dawn of Greek philosophy, in the decisive sense of participating in a fundamental initiation into being itself in its truth. Thinkers are begun by this beginning, incepted by this inception, and gathered into it. Gadamer, a student of Heidegger, will suggest that the unnamed goddess is Nemosune. Hestia, again, is another candidate because she, too, exists in the middle of the sphere, as a student of Pythagoras, Philolaus of Croton says. The goddess may be Night is argued for because she's said in the poem to live in the house of Night, which has sometimes given rise to her identification with the Nyx of the Orphic Rhapsodists. Let's focus now a bit more in detail on the way of truth versus the way of opinion. In his 1926 lectures on ancient philosophy, Heidegger emphasizes that there are no degrees, no partaking in the one side as well as the other. On the contrary, truth, just like being and non-being, is absolute, either or, truth or mere semblance. How shall we recognize which path we're on, the path of truth or the path of opinion? According to Parmenides, again, very mystically, when we're on the way of being, we recognize it by spherical signs. As he writes, only one tail is left of the way that it is, and on this are posted very many signs, that which is ungenerated, imperishable, whole of one kind, unperturbed and complete. Never was it, nor shall it be, since it now is, altogether one continuous within the shackles of justice. Nor is it divisible, further, motionless and without beginning or end, it is complete from every direction, like to the mass of a well-rounded sphere, equally resistant from the center in all directions, inviolate, equal to itself in every direction, it equally meets with limits. This is a large number of very complicated attributes, all here attributed to the untrembling, well-rounded heart of truth, Aletheia, also named in Parmenides the Sphairos. We're going to get into each of these attributes in a moment, and we turn to Heidegger's reading of them. For now, it suffices to underline that this fragment also indicates Parmenides as the first presentist, that is, the doctrine that only the present exists, or exists truly every other dimension of time, the past, the future, participating in some sense with what is not. Other than the principle of identity and the principle of non-contradiction, so far been given very little indication as to how to recognize the path of truth or stay on it. Rather, it is decked out like Anaximander's Apeiron with a series of highly philosophical superlatives, all intended to be perceived phenomenologically by the one who walks on the way and notices the very many signs. Again, the emphasis here is on the religious experience in Parmenides, not the logic. We really perceive being and all of reality in the ways Parmenides suggests. Heidegger breaks down the traits of being perceptible in our phenomenological horizons as such, that we would see in all things the one being or the truth of being as unborn, undying, a whole, unique, unshakable, without end, no past, no future, ever-present, altogether one and self-cohesive. Nietzsche will argue that this is a very rarefied and abstract conceptuality, and in fact is very world-denying, in that in the world as we experience it, in fact, we see almost always what is born or dying, what is fragmentary, not a whole, patterns, not singular events. which we can shake and unseat, not those which exist forever untrembling. We exist always in ends and limits, or mortal finitude. And although only the present ever is for us, there is always our past which we carry along with us, as well as the future which we anticipate. So much of what we live through is never, ever wholly present, or altogether, or one, but rather a plurality or multiplicity. And the self-cohesiveness of the one is hardly ever experienced in mortal temporality. If Nietzsche is right here, then Parmenides' doctrine of being may indeed be world-denying. On the other hand, it could be a formal indication of the traces of the one in the multiplicity, or the traces of the way of truth in the way of opinion, a kind of mystical manual for how to engage with and understand the being of all things. Parmenides is also the first philosopher we've studied so far who seems to have an in-depth theory of the origin and nature of consciousness. For as in each case is the blending of the much wandering parts, so is thought present in men. How can thinking and being be the same if thought is present in human beings only as a blending of much wandering parts? Here, Parmenides' theory of consciousness seems to be the first to propose epiphenomenalism, a doctrine still current in the philosophy of mind. According to this way of thinking, for it is the same thing which the constitution of the parts of men each and every one thinks, for the excess is thought, to gar plion esti noema. In other words, while thought is nothing other than the gathering together of all of the constitutive parts that produce it, such as biological components, neurons in the brain, or conceptual components, nevertheless, what thought itself is an overflow, something supererogatory. These debates are already anachronistic. Parmenides' fragment merely says, that which exceeds, or the fullness, or excess, is thinking, or is thought. Regardless of whether we take it as an early statement of parallelism or epiphenomenalism, this is indisputably the earliest materialist view on the genesis of thought, which is odd, considering it's coming from an idealist and monist philosopher. Suggests that epistemology and ontology are intimately related in Parmenides in ways we can't quite make out because we've lost many of the fragments, the second and third part of the poem, which probably spelt this all out more clearly. This is why Heidegger tends to start not from to gar plion esti noema, which is quite obscure, but rather the same thing is thinking as well as being, to gar oto noin estin te kai inai, or simply translated, thinking and being are the same. Suggests that although thinking arises from an excess to the finite constitution of parts which produces it, is, nevertheless, for finite mortal creatures like us, our only site of access to being itself. Stupidity occurs as a deficit of thinking, instead a reliance on inherited opinions. For most of our lives, mortals knowing nothing wander two-headed, Parmenides writes, for helplessness in their breasts directs a wandering mind, and they are born both deaf and dumb, dazed, undiscerning tribes, by whom to be and not to be are thought to be the same and not the same, and the path of all is backwards turning. Parmenides, the real problem of humanity is our thoughtlessness or stupidity, confuse what is and what is not. Let's now look at Parmenides' main argument in a bit more detail with Stamatelos. In his poem, Parmenides aims at justifying the unique and unconditional existence of being through the rational refutation of non-being. His method is to make what is, taken at the simplest and most basic level, into a subject of speech and thought, and then he deduces the characteristics of eternity, changelessness, and immobility from this basic premise by a chain of irrefutable arguments. In this argumentative style, the premises are thought and being are the same, nothing is not, and nothing or kenon, the void, cannot be thought. From these three premises or axioms follow three irrefutable conclusions. There is not a many, there can be no change, and even time must be an illusion. Of course, as anyone in the class, even vaguely familiar with logic and its argumentative structures, will note, there really has been no definitive deduction at this point between the three premises and the three conclusions. Parmenides' own statements in the poem don't arrive at these conclusions so clearly as stated here. The forms these conclusions take are determined by Parmenides' student, Zeno, and also Melissus. What if Zeno's famous paradoxes were intended to be precisely reductio ad absurdums? Acknowledge the existence of multiplicity, of change, and of time, attributes of the thought and being that are the same, which can be thought since they are not nothing. This is why this slide is titled How Parmenides is Usually Misunderstood. Nietzsche would agree with Stamatelos' interpretation here, but according to Heidegger, Nietzsche is wrong. Let's see how this all plays out. According to Nietzsche, Parmenides is the anti-Heraclitus. He stands as a counter-image, likewise expressing a type of truth-teller, but one formed of ice rather than fire, pouring cold, piercing light all around. Parmenides' initiatory event, or journey to hear the goddess, was the once-in-a-lifetime moment for Nietzsche, probably at a fairly advanced age. Note already that Nietzsche is defying the clear statement that the one who undergoes this initiation is a kouros, or youth. In any case, the initiatory event of Parmenides is read by Nietzsche as a moment of absolutely bloodless abstraction, unclouded by any physical reality. This moment, un-Greek as no other in the two centuries of the tragic age, whose product is the doctrine of being, became for Parmenides' own life the boundary stone that separates two periods. That is, the Anaximandrian period of Ionian philosophy versus the Parmenidean period of Eleatic philosophy. This is probably the most common way of reading Parmenides, as an absolute break with Ionian natural philosophy. According to Heidegger and also to Caritani, as we'll see, this view is incorrect. To Parmenidean cosmology and astronomy, we don't have much surviving, but this fragment is interesting. You shall know the ethereal nature and all the signs in ether, and the unseen works of the pure torch, of the blazing sun, and whence they came to be. And you shall learn the revolving works of the round-eyed moon and her nature, and you shall know the surrounding heaven, when it grew, and how necessity led it in shackles to keep the limits of the stars. From this and a few other fragments, we can infer that Parmenides devised an elaborate system of celestial rings, or stephane, crowns, which later supported Aristotle's theory of the crystalline spheres for heavenly bodies. For Stamatelos, the Eleatics challenged the very basis of cosmology by arguing against change, generation, and plurality. In his Way of Truth, Parmenides argued against all cosmological assumptions, but in the part of his poem known as the Way of Opinion, he constructed a world of light and night with the help of a complex system of garlands, stephane, or crowns, of light comparable to the wheels in Anaximander's cosmology. A fire goddess named Justice, Dike, and necessity, Anike, steers all and guides all, holding the limits of the stars in the surrounding heaven of the universe. The sun itself is described as an exhalation of fire vaporized from the earth like the circle of the Milky Way. The moon itself is night shining, borrowing its light, wandering about the earth based on whichever of its faces is turned to the sun. Metellus underlines that in Parmenides' Way of Opinion, we can only fragmentarily reconstruct, he seems to offer theories which are only probable, that is, not derived from the immediate phenomenology of the Way of Truth. Maybe so, but why then does the reconstruction of Parmenides' cosmological doctrine fit so neatly in the description of cosmic structures provided in the prologue? It seems to me that Parmenides' cosmological speculations are also rooted, at least to some extent, in the sensuous experiences of initiatory revelation or shamanic journeying. This completely flies in the face, again, of Nietzsche's approach. For Parmenides, truth is only the palest, most abstract generality, an empty husk of the most indefinite terms, as though in a house of cobwebs. Beside such truth now sits our philosopher, likewise as bloodless as his abstractions, in the spun-out fabric of his formulas. A spider at least wants blood from its victims. The Parmenidean philosopher hates most of all the blood of his victims, the blood of the empirical reality which was sacrificed and shed by him. There are some interesting fragments on the goddess Aphrodite in Parmenides, which seems to make him a precursor of Empedocles' theory of two cosmic principles, love and strife. The most significant line in Parmenides being, first of all the gods, she devised Eros, most likely referring to Aphrodite here. In Nietzsche, it is the power of Aphrodite that weds the opposites, the existent with the non-existent. Desire unites the contradictory and mutually repellent elements, and the result is coming to be. When desire is satiated, hatred and inner opposition drives the existent and the non-existent apart once more, and man says, all things pass. Unlike in Heraclitus, where the opposites were always a unity, from the start and throughout the process of differentiation. In Parmenides, the opposites represent positive and negative poles, existent and inexistent polarities. This is indeed where we can locate the difference between Parmenides and Heraclitus correctly, in an evaluative preference for the positive, truth and being, over semblance, non-being, and the negative, overemphasizing the tautology that only what is, indeed lead to tenacious misinterpretations. Nietzsche goes on, "Now grasping the firm and awful hand of tautological truth about being, he can climb down into the abyss of things." Here, reframing Parmenides' journey to the horizon as a descent, katabasis. On his way down, he meets Heraclitus, an unhappy encounter. Caring now for nothing except the strictest separation of being from non-being, he must hate in his deepest soul the antinomy play of Heraclitus. Oppositions such as we are and at the same time are not, being and non-being is at the same time the same and not the same, tangle and cloud everything which he had just illumined and distinguished. They drove him to fury, that is to rage, or for Nietzsche, madness. "Away with those people," he screamed, "who seem to have two heads and yet know nothing. Everything is in flux for them, including their thinking. They stand in dull astonishment before things and yet must be deaf as well as blind to mix up the opposites the way they do." For Nietzsche, Parmenides' so-called monomaniacal monism can be explained through the influence of Xenophanes, who, remember, lived a very long time, again emphasizing the gerontological, or logos of the old man, perspective. It was the one of Xenophanes, after all the mobility of his wanderings, provides to Parmenides as well a vision of divine rest, and of the permanence of all things within a pantheistic archetypal peace. Parmenides emerges as the model of the wise old sage, namely in Latin, the solus ipse, the soul alone with itself, or great monology. Yet Parmenides received his initiation, if he is indeed the Kurus in the Prome, when he was very young. In this way, classical scholars and students of Parmenides must learn to speak about two Parmenides: the wise old man, fanatic of the one and stability, the haunting ghost of Plato's emphasis on eternity and the forms. First Parmenides, for Nietzsche, seeks only escape from becoming and the opposites, a kind of concept mummy of peace and being, mystic absorption in the one and an all-sufficing ecstatic state of mind, beyond the enigmas and vexations of ordinary existence. Not sure how any reader of the prologue could say this, but Nietzsche does, that Parmenides' thinking conveys nothing whatever of the dark, intoxicating fragrance of Hindu wisdom, so is decisively mystical, that is, mystical in the bad sense, unlike Pythagoras and Empedocles. Nietzsche, Parmenides becomes a puppet of schematism and abstraction, a very un-Greek Greek whose philosophical instinct was motivated by an absolute striving for certainty, a very modern notion in the history of philosophy, not quite an ancient one. Parmenides simply lacks imagination, his prayer being, "Grant me, ye gods, but one certainty, and if it be but a log's breadth on which to lie, on which to ride upon the sea of uncertainty, take away everything that comes to be, everything lush, colorful, blossoming, illusory, everything that charms and is alive, take all these for yourselves and grant me but the one and only poor, empty certainty." It certainly seems to me that Nietzsche is here railing against certain tendencies in modern philosophy, not at all Parmenides, at least as we've been given to read. And here we find the rub of Heidegger's overall criticism of Nietzsche. For Heidegger, being is mysterious, something we must learn to think anew. For Nietzsche, being is the emptiest concept, most general relationship which connects all things. Being is not a real predicate, and so the closest to non-being. Nietzsche, through words and concepts, we shall never reach beyond the wall of relations to some sort of fabulous primal ground of things. Even in the pure form of sense and understanding, in space, time, and causality, we gain nothing that resembles an eternal truth. Nietzsche's epistemology and ontology of being here are clearly thoroughly determined by Kant and Schopenhauer. Nietzsche also assimilates his vision of Parmenides with Hegelian philosophy, according to which the absolute is absolutely present, or in Beneke's reading of Hegel, which Nietzsche quotes, that being must be given to us somehow, must be somehow attainable. If it were not, we would not have the concept. For the next 15 years, to the twilight of the idols, Nietzsche will continue to rail against the very concept of being, its low empirical origins. Quote, "For esse," Latin for being or to be, "essentially means to breathe. That is life, which we only project onto other things in terms of metaphors, which are decisively non-logical processes. For Nietzsche, we understand the being of other beings always only on the basis of analogy. In other words, the concept and all our speculative philosophies are nothing more than anthropomorphic, non-logical projections on the basis of our own experience. If this is the epistemology that suits you, you will indeed prefer Nietzsche to Heidegger. Note, however, how little any of this has to do with Parmenides. So let's turn now to Heidegger's reading of Parmenides, first in his 1926 lectures. According to Heidegger, Karl Reinhardt's 1926 book, Parmenides and the History of Greek Philosophy, unfortunately still untranslated, has set Parmenides' studies on a new basis and reevaluated the false opposition with Heraclitus. But at the beginning of Heidegger's Parmenides interpretation, we get a very clear statement. Karl Reinhardt's Parmenides is to be preferred to Nietzsche's. Karl Reinhardt is one of the first in the 20th century to resituate Parmenides within Ionian natural philosophy. Parmenides' basic problem is indeed being, unity, the non-oppositional, the is. Being is graspable in knowing, thought, apprehension, understanding, truth. This makes up almost the whole of Parmenidean ontology. World of becoming, or phusis, in which we are enmeshed, is always an object of opinion, or doxa. Hence the two ways and the difference between ontology and epistemology. For Heidegger, the attempt to say that Parmenides' cosmology and theory of becoming is merely a probable hypothesis or disputational exercise is misguided. Throughout the way of opinion, for Heidegger and Reinhardt, truth, just like being and non-being, remains absolute. Either or, truth or mere semblance. After Reinhardt, we simply cannot give credence to Nietzsche's Parmenides or take it seriously. The real issue for Heidegger is to understand how untruth belongs to being in Parmenides. According to the phrase, to the being of truth belongs essentially the untruth. Goddess of truth shows and leads the way to the disclosure of being as such. She keeps Parmenides far from the other way, but he must still understand that other way at the same time. Thus it is clear the cause of error is not overcome through refutation and proof of impossible consequences, but only if error is understood in its origin. Zeno's paradoxes here could be interpreted as refutation and proof of the impossible consequences that follow when we assume that motion does not exist. Motion indeed exists and is part of being. Paradoxes lead us from the way of opinion back to the way of truth, by dispelling common errors about motion so as to think its being anew. Too often in Parmenides' studies, we simply oppose the way of truth to the way of opinion. Must recall with Heidegger that there are three ways: truth, mere semblance, and then opinion. Origin of error is to be found in the way of semblance, taking what is not for what is. Semblance is what merely appears outwardly to be such, but is not so. Semblance is the rival of that which shows itself from itself, or being. Goddess's lesson for the young thinker in Heidegger is that insofar as Dasein, or human existence, is, it is already in the way of untruth, on the path of error. Though very often, and in many places in the world, things show themselves for what they are, our enmeshment in the world of doxa by history and tradition makes it quite difficult for us to recognize mere semblance or mere appearance contaminated by non-being for what it is. Rather, simply assume semblances into the concept and believe we've understood them. Parmenides, we must first have a revelation or initiatory experience of being itself in its truth. Only then can we work our way out of opinions, recognizing the cause of error in the way of semblance. Being permeated by errancy, Dasein is already on this way, insofar as Dasein is underway at all. The way of semblance always leads to the way of false opinions, whereas the way of true semblance leads to true opinions. Thus Heidegger accounts for the unity of the three parts of Parmenides' prome. Heidegger helpfully and clearly points out that what always compels us onto the path of semblance and errancy is always the polupeiron eros, that is, our many-fangled desire. It becomes a habit in those of much experience. Why? Because of how we want things to be. What is usual for us, that which is commonly known and said about things. Way of defining reality in terms of what we would like reality to be, not extraneous, contingent, but part of the order of being, the necessary way of being of creatures like us. So because of our desire for things to be thus and so, we are always already on the path of untruth. Here in Heidegger, Parmenides ends up sounding a lot more rather than less like Heraclitus. For Parmenides as well, desire leads us into private worlds which are not, whereas being subtends all our existencing as what is shared or zoonon, that is presencing. At this point, Parmenides' being sounds exactly like Heraclitus' logos. The logos of being as what is shared in presencing returns our gaze from the born towards the unborn, from the mortals towards the immortals, the fragmentary towards the whole, from the repeatable to the unique, from the shakable to the unshakable, etc. And here Parmenides' being is more rather than less like the one which alone is wise, the Sophon or Zeus. Not convinced at this point, Heidegger now turns to one of the attributes of being in the sphericity of Parmenides' doctrine of truth, specifically the claim that being is motionless, or akinaton. Rather than being a doctrine that being is beyond and somehow negational of time, in the naive opposition of time versus eternity, by motionless being, what Parmenides means is the now point, the constant which stays. Time is only ever experienced in the now. The now is constant, it stays, and time stays. For it is only from the present that time is. This is not an atemporal doctrine in Parmenides, but precisely a recognition of the reality of time within a pagan cyclical cosmology, without beginning or end. Coming to be and passing away always reflect the same, only ever graspable in a now that constantly comes to presence. Now is in every now constantly itself, this now. This does not claim that time and motion are merely illusory, only that time and motion are from being, as what gives, in truth and in untruth, the phenomena of motion and time. In his 1942 Parmenides lectures, the lecture series delivered immediately after the Heraclitus lectures we studied last week, Heidegger further entrenches Parmenides' status as a philosopher within the Ionian tradition. Rather than setting up oppositions between Anaximander, Heraclitus, and Parmenides, what we must recognize is that they were all uncovering being itself. None of them were primitive thinkers or proto-scientists, but rather primordial thinkers of a transformed fundamental relationship of the human being to being. And Parmenides' goddess is not a metaphor or allegorical device for the purposes of a didactic poem, but emerges from the reality of an initiatory encounter. The thinker Parmenides tells of a goddess who greets him as he arrives at her home in the course of his travels. To the greeting, whose proper essence the goddess herself clarifies, she adds an announcement of the revelations she has in store for the thinker as he goes on his way. The dictum of this thinker speaks by bringing into language the word of this goddess. Not so much matter if the goddess is named Aletheia as if she were the goddess of truth for Heidegger, because what the goddess speaks is itself truth. Surely the sayings of a goddess are a mythos, not a logos, a representation, not philosophy of being. To think this way misses who Parmenides really was and what he really said, in favor of a later doxographical tradition, identifying him as the father of logic, clearly not a mythical thinker. For Heidegger, mythos and logos in Parmenides are one and the same, the separation of mythos and logos only beginning in earnest after Plato. We cannot dismiss the poetical or pseudo-mythical decorations of Parmenides' philosophy in favor of some abstraction of his philosophical system, for when we do that, we entirely miss his point. As long as we make no attempt to think the Greek gods in the Greek way, on the basis of the essence of the Greek experiences of being and truth, that is, on the basis of aletheia, then we have no right to say a word about these gods, whether in favor of them or against them. Mythos is legend. Essentially primordial speech, like the logos of Heraclitus. The deities resident in language, night, light, earth, are a mythi, actual sayings of these things, invocations of these divine powers, such as in the simple transition of night and day, hymns to Nyx or hymns to Hemera, the dawn, enhance what comes to presence in the mythos, saying or logos. Parmenides' own mythos being of an absolute horizon, an eternal twilight, between night and day. Why do we find the revelatory understanding of truth, or truth as aletheia, unconcealing or unforgetting, so difficult to understand? Well, that's because we're not just post-Greek, we're also post-Roman. sovereign power and communicative consensus over a domain to be controlled dictates a very different concept of truth. Not truth as unconcealing, but truth as correctness, veritas. Very important for Heidegger to note that the ancient Greeks did not define truth merely as correctness. Although we find a discussion of truth as orthotes, or what is correct or right, as early as Plato, Greeks always had a deeper notion of truth in mind at the same time. It is only through Roman philosophy and later Christian thought, eventually leading to Thomas Aquinas, that we find the simple medieval idea that truth is merely the correspondence of the intellect with the thing. That is a correspondence theory of truth. I make a proposition, defining the reference of each of my terms as far as possible, and that proposition in the mind that thinks it corresponds or fails to correspond to some existing reality, the truth out there. In this way, the phenomena of truth as a lived experience is totally reduced to what Heidegger calls the mode of the true, that is, making a true statement. Surely it would be absurd to understand all the propositions of Greek philosophy as merely concerned with making true statements about things in the matter of contemporary theories of meaning such as Frege on sense and reference. What the Greeks were concerned with was clearly more decisive and mythical experience of truth in which beings as a whole are transformed by the thinker who apprehends them, and in which human existence itself enters into the being of beings in such a way that its very essence is transformed. So moving on from Heidegger for now, we can summarize that Heidegger's understanding of lethe as oblivion or concealment suggests there was a counter-relation, a kind of strife between concealing and unconcealing that held sway in ancient Greek Dasein, or ancient Greek life and thought. Heidegger's project can be construed as attempting to retrieve a more indigenous or archaic Greek understanding of the experience of truth. And according to Heidegger, most of our understanding of the archaic Greek thinkers and their world has devolved into mere ideological projection based on Christian Platonism. We have no genuine access to the pre-Socratic life world, which is why we should learn to speak Greek, read all the studies, and learn to understand Heidegger. Why do we do this when we study the pre-Socratics? Well, because it feels safe and convenient to construct a myth of the dawn of Western civilization and to imagine that we have progressed since then. Heidegger is daring enough to venture the idea that even though all we have are fragments of archaic philosophy, these are enough for a thoughtful reader to discern that we are in fact living in errancy with respect to the experience of truth. Modern science only solidifying the idea of truth as the true, not alleviating this core existential plight. We need truth, not just the true. So where does Caritani stand on these debates over how to interpret Parmenides? I would say, without mentioning him, firmly on the side of Heidegger. For Caritani, Parmenides is typically regarded as having played the most important role in the shift from Ionian natural philosophy to Athenian philosophy, that is, the Eleatic, Parmenides being the basis of Athenian or classical thought. However, this view is chiefly that of the Athenian philosophers. It seems rather to me that what brought about a decisive shift in Ionian philosophy was Pythagoras, and that Heraclitus and Parmenides were figures that resisted this change. The Eleatic versus Ionian distinction is not all it's cracked up to be. Parmenides has deep ties to Ionia. He was a citizen of Elea, a Greek colony settled by Ionian immigrants, and he is said to have been influenced by the Pythagorean school and taken residence with its order for a time. Through his own ancestry, he was influenced, as we mentioned earlier, from traditions further west. Aristotle writes in the Metaphysics, it is said that Parmenides was a pupil of Xenophanes. Pythagoras, despite his Ionian origin, rejected Ionian natural philosophy. For Caritani, Xenophanes placed himself completely within its lineage. Very different Xenophanes than the one you find in Nietzsche. Caritani reconciles the testimony about who influenced Parmenides by saying, well, Parmenides received early training in the Pythagorean school and then became a pupil of Xenophanes. The lifelong task of Parmenides in this narrative becomes that of overcoming Pythagorean thought, rather than being its ally in a line leading to Plato. What Parmenides does is precisely to recuperate Ionian natural philosophy. So if this is the case, then why do we have such deep-seated prejudices as to how to understand Parmenides, according to which Parmenides says only being exists, whereas Heraclitus says only becoming? Well, this was Hegel's understanding, but Hegel was wrong. Key point for Ionian natural philosophy is to discover the arche or origin in self-moving matter. Here, matter and motion are inseparable, and it is Pythagoras who separates them rather than Parmenides. According to the misguided interpretation of Parmenides, we should see the world as static, motion as only an illusion, this merely apparent motion being simply a multiplication of number from the one to the many. Reading Parmenides in this way, he promoted the one and denied mobility. But he actually denied, however, the Pythagorean view of two worlds, the sensible and the intelligible, self-moving matter still being the spheros, or the one, the unshaking heart of truth that moves across the way of truth, way of semblance, and way of opinion. In fact, Parmenides and Heraclitus agree on almost everything of decisive importance. If we take the Pythagorean view privileging number or the intelligible, then motion becomes an illusion, simply does not exist. What Parmenides rejects is this static view of the world. He affirms self-moving matter by method of indirect proof. Heraclitus had said that self-moving matter becoming is. Parmenides and his disciples say, well, assume it isn't, and you will devolve into absurdities, thus reaffirming the Ionian natural view of the world by the method of indirect proof. Far from being a pedant of abstractions, Caritani's Zeno is a decisively political figure, his scorn for the masses and tyrants, like Heraclitus's, deriving from the spirit of isonomia. Look closely at all the Parmenidean fragments, and we never find a rejection of the world of sense. What exists is one is a statement of the ground of being of the world of sense. And what it rejects is the idea that what the senses reveal is ultimately nothing, permeated by the void. Recall for Heidegger that Heraclitus is a thinker of phusis, nature, and of aletheia, that which never sets, or truth. Parmenides' proem on nature speaks precisely this way, of the untrembling, well-rounded heart of truth. So Parmenides and Heraclitus agree on truth as the logos of being, and they both provide a cosmology of phusis. Lastly, Parmenides' very name for being, to aeon, is very similar to Heraclitus's eonta zunon, as being as sharing or giving beings in common, the search for the true or hidden laws of nature which unify the beginning and end in the circumference of the circle. Recall that for Parmenides, the void is nothing, what is not, and nothing is not. What is, on the other hand, is one. This means, as it were, the permanence of matter. Caritani links this rejection of the idea of the void or nothingness also to a critique of pre-Ionian thought, that is Hesiod's Chaos, as well as post-Ionian thought, Pythagoras. Sorry to reiterate, but this really needs drilling in. Parmenides' claims are not a rejection of motion or becoming. His vision of the coherence and unity of the three ways is a philosophical vision of matter that moves itself. So although it can look, when we listen too much to Nietzsche, or Stamatelos even, as if Eleatic philosophy is responsible for Aristotle and Plato's emphasis on the theory of ideas, actually, that's the Pythagorean influence on Athenian thought, not Parmenides. What Parmenides maintained is that motion is indivisible, one, and he sought to show this by indirect proof, a method we see also in Zeno. The source of all the trouble is the unqualified trust that scholars and doxographers tend to give to Plato and his dialogue, the Parmenides. Zeno is depicted as proving the absurdity which follows from supposing the existence of the many. This is not the only way to read Zeno's paradoxes. They could be taken as demonstrating the impossibility of multiplicity or motion. They could also be taken as demonstrating that multiplicity and motion are impossible if one holds the views of the Pythagoreans. In other words, Zeno's paradoxes are aimed to refute the Pythagorean school at the premise. So what are motion, becoming, and change? They are always only present in the one. What Parmenides underlines for Caritani is the paradox of the passage of time. As soon as we say this moment, it's already gone. But in the true now, it is not just the past and the present do not exist. Even the now does not exist. It is what Parmenides called the one being. Parmenides' thought experiment and method of indirect proof guides us, epagoge, to see motion, becoming, and transformation in the midst of its arising, precisely not as abstractions. Thinking as the excess of matter is precisely what makes thinking and being the same. This has often been taken as a statement of idealism to the effect that thinking determines being. That sounds altogether too much like Protagorean relativism, however. What Parmenides is really saying is the opposite. Being exists and all thinking deals with being. When we lose coherence in thinking, it means the object of thinking cannot be real, as for example, the canon or void. Far from rejecting the materialist thought of the Ionians in favor of an idealist monism, Parmenides takes Ionian materialism as a premise. The illusion Parmenides sought to clear was born of reason. This is the exact opposite of Nietzsche's reading of Parmenides as a worshipper of abstractions. Nietzsche was led to this view through Schopenhauer's misinterpretation of Kant. As it turns out for Caritani, Parmenides' doctrine of thinking and being as the same finds its true spiritual inheritor only in Immanuel Kant's critique of the illusions produced by reason. Caritani, Kant is the greatest Parmenidean since Parmenides. Just like Parmenides, he makes a distinction between three things principally: the thing in itself, the phenomena, and illusion. Kant remains a materialist, who affirms that things reside externally. His last text before his death, or Opus Posthumus, is a treatise on the limits of idealist physics. What consciousness captures is not things in themselves or noumena, but subjectively constructed phenomena. The distinction Kant proposes between phenomena and thing in itself may have appeared to be another version of a dual world theory, the illusory world of the senses versus the true world of reason. Actually, it's a restatement of the tripartite structure of Parmenides' Prome. A close examination of mental and physical phenomena mapping onto the way of truth, the false postulate of the thing in itself being a necessary errancy, which permeates the way of semblance, and the way of opinion being full of both truth and illusions. Real illusion for Parmenides is the Pythagorean view of the world, which rejects sensible realities and claims to discover the origin of things in a divine intuition. Parmenides clears away these types of illusions, roots out their source, and moves on to inquire into the domain of human opinions. It is not incidental that the next generation of Eleatic thinkers would use precisely Parmenides' method in order to come up with the atomic theory. It seems to me that Heidegger, were he around, would agree with Caritani on every point, and vice versa. In Heidegger's own reading, Zeno is pursuing consequences of the hypothesis that motion does not exist on the basis of Parmenides' conception of being. The consequences are impossible, hence the hypothesis is destroyed. Zeno does not provide a new positive clarification of the philosophy of being, but only argumentation to overpower the denial of Parmenides' thesis. Heidegger even identifies the hypothesis that is to be destroyed as that of Pythagoras, in all essential points cohering with Caritani's reading. I won't go into it here, but you can cross-check Caritani and Heidegger's findings against Stamatellos' overall reading of Zeno's biography and argument. The only way for Zeno to retain Parmenides' concept of the one in this argument is through misidentifying it with the concept of infinity. Just as we have two Parmenideses in the history of interpretation, thus we have two Zenos, the one which Plato, Aristotle, and Simplicius give us, versus the original Zeno. Melissus of Samos is the third important Eleatic philosopher after Parmenides and Zeno. In the Stamatellos, he was a naval commander famous for his victories, especially one against the Athenian fleet in 441 BCE. He wrote one philosophical book in prose, either on nature or on what exists, of which only 10 fragments survive, again preserved by Simplicius. Melissus' philosophy is basically in line with Parmenides', but with a few differences. He agrees with Parmenides' conclusions on the indestructibility, immobility, indivisibility, oneness, completeness, and changeless perfection of being, but develops different views on timelessness and infinity. In a way here, Melissus' doctrine of infinity is being projected back into Zeno's paradoxes. His main contribution is the notion of the infinity of being as regards its temporal everlastingness and spatial limitlessness. Being is eternal and without limit, and one and a homogeneous whole. The argument here is complicated, but the upshot, in terms of Melissus' disagreement with Parmenides, is that for Parmenides, being never was in the past and never will be in the future, but is only now, in a timeless present, whereas for Melissus, being is, always was, and always will be in eternity. This drift towards eternity and infinity in our basic understanding of being must be understood as a stepping stone towards Plato's reading of Parmenides. To be sure, as Stamatellos writes, being is a main topic of inquiry for the Eleatic philosophers. Is it really in opposition to the Ionian flux of temporal becoming? Is it really stable and timeless? Can we really project Melissus's modifications back into Zeno and then Parmenides? His conclusion, Stamatelos, opens up the same possibilities of interpretation we found in Heidegger and Caritani, according to which Parmenides should rather be situated within the lineage of Ionian natural philosophy. For what he denied was not being, in favor of existence or even natural existence, as an unqualified and universally determined and determining being. In a world in which there is no birth and death, spatial extension, or past and future, but ultimately only one eternal present, all at once. This week, we'll be looking at Empedocles of Akrakas, who reconciled Ionian becoming with Eleatic being in an ontological synthesis. The pluralism of Empedocles is in fact the inheritor of the correct view of an Ionian Parmenides. So getting out of all the abstraction, I wanted to conclude this lecture by going over the material in Stamatelos' chapter on the soul in pre-Socratic philosophy. It will also help to prepare for us the transition from Parmenides to Empedocles. But as this lecture is already a decent length, we'll save that for next week. Thanks for listening and see you then.